giving it a final boost. Good morning. I'm going to take my mask off. We'd like to invite you to worship with us this morning. Our first song has come. Now is the time to worship. And how appropriate is that?
Just as you are to worship, come. Okay, we're going to try that again. Okay, when I say good morning, you're supposed to say it back to me, okay? So let's try this. Good morning. That's better. That's better. That sounds like a group of people who've come together to praise and glorify God. It's a wonderful day for us to worship together. So let's begin our time together by joining in a spirit of prayer. Let's pray. With different gifts, with a variety of talents, with an array of interests, we come to worship you, O God. We're here to unite our spirits, to be made one in Jesus Christ, to be merged in hope as your children. Bless our differences so that the unique gifts and perceptions that each of us bring to this time of worship will strengthen our oneness. Draw us into your spirit. In the name of the living God, we pray. Amen. Our opening hymn is a hymn called Alleluia. Let's stand together and join in singing.
Most of you probably have heard and know. You may stand, you may sit, you may sing along. You don't have to sing. You can do whatever your heart feels. And join with us as we do Great Are You, Lord. Give life.
Where we turn to our Lord in prayer, we of course take the time to remember those in our church family who are in our prayers in a special way. First of all, we want to offer our prayers of thanksgiving to God in that Tammy Abadie is back with us in the booth today. She's been with her new grandchild and helping out there. She's back with us, and I can tell you what, the one person who's the most excited about that is me. Because dealing with the people back there that I've been having to deal with without her around has not been easy. Tammy, it is good to have you back. And good to have you straightening out those other two men that are back there. As we celebrate that joy, we also celebrate some sadness in our family of faith. Miss Dorothy Pemberton is quite ill. And she has been moved to hospice. She was doing great a week ago and developed some issues that her little body's just not able to overcome. So I'm going to be anxious to get back over there today right after the service and visit with them for a while. I've spent a lot of time with them this week, and it's a matter of time. And so we want to lift her up and her family in our prayers. We also want to continue to remember Miss Botusa, who continues under the care of hospice. And we want to continue to pray for Sherry Gertis as she is on the kidney transplant waiting list and anxiously awaiting that transplant. And I want to express our gratitude, and I know her gratitude, to you for the generosity that you have shown her in the contributions to her medical fund. We're going to be able to help pay for a lot of these medications that her insurance won't cover after this surgery is over. So thanks to you for that. We continue to remember her. Is there anyone that you would like to lift up this morning in a special way? If so, I'd like you to simply say their names aloud at this time. Well, with all these names in mind, let's turn to God now in prayer. Almighty God, in these moments, we join our hearts and we join our spirits together in love, in concern, and in prayer for these we have mentioned here today. In these moments, we lift up to you our own personal needs and our own personal prayers. There are many who are hurting, many who are struggling, many who are grieving. And at the same time, there are many of us who are celebrating new gifts and new experiences and new expectations. All of our hearts and all of our spirits are united together in these moments in prayer. Dear Father, in these moments we praise you for your character. We praise you for your faithfulness when so many around us do not seem to be so faithful. Your constant love surrounds us even when we may not even sense it. We are confident in your provisions for our needs, even if it might not be obvious to us yet. Help us to see in ourselves your provision for us and your everlasting love through your caring arms and your sensitive heart. Prepare our minds, our wills, and our emotions, as well as our spirits, for heeding the call to be your people, to be your church in this world. Look clearly into our hearts as we worship you and as we praise you, as we hear your word and as we respond to it. We pray that we might receive all that you have to give us this morning. And after doing so, we would pray that our lips and our lives would glorify you through what we offer in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. We pray this prayer in his name. And we pray in the way he taught us to pray when he prayed these words. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, we would like to honor God and worship God through the gifts, the tithes, and the offerings that we offer to God. If you're prepared to do so today, we invite you to bring your gift and place it here in the offering plate at the front of the church. You can do so at the one in the back. We invite you to take advantage of online giving if you wish. In whatever way we can be generous and support the work of our church, let us do so now.
Regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. Bring the ashes, a new life is born. Jesus is calling.
A reading from John, chapter 1, verses 43 to 51. Jesus chooses Philip and Nathanael. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. There he met Philip, who was from Bethsaida, the hometown of Andrew and Peter. And Jesus said to Philip, "Come with me." Philip then found Nathanael and said, "We have found the one that Moses and the prophets wrote about. He is Jesus, the son of Joseph from Nazareth." And Nathanael asked, "Can anything good come from Nazareth?" And Philip answered, "Come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him, he said, "Here is a true descendant of our ancestor Israel, and he isn't deceitful." "How do you know me?" Nathanael asked. And Jesus answered, "Before Philip called you, I saw you under the fig tree." Nathanael said, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God and the King of Israel." Jesus answered, "Did you believe me just because I said I saw you under the fig tree? You will see something even greater. I tell you for certain that you will see heaven open and God's angels going up and coming down on the Son of Man." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Would you join with me in a spirit of prayer? Almighty God, in these moments, move your spirit into our hearts and our minds and our souls so that we might receive your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you were here last week or you were watching online, you heard me at the end of the service tell you that since they were children, my children and I have always had an agreement. Anytime I use them as an illustration in one of my sermons, I have to pay them $10. And after what I said last week about how ugly their baby pictures were, I had to take out a small loan to cover that one. But I took out enough to cover what I'm about to tell you now. As many of you know, our son Jordy, back this May, graduated from Louisiana Tech with his master's degree in architecture. And we were very proud of him and excited about that. And then, of course, after he graduated, he moved out of the house he was renting in Ruston, and he moved back to us. And he moved into one of our bedrooms. And then he announced to us that he didn't want to really start searching for a job immediately. That he wanted to take a couple of months off, you know, to rest and relax. And we were okay with that. You know, he'd been working for 5 years and he worked hard, you know, to finish his schooling. Yeah, take a couple of months off. So I got a little calendar. I put it up in the laundry room, and I marked the day that he said that. And I counted exactly 60 days from that date. And when that 61st day rolled around, start looking for a job. Your little vacation is over. He said, I know, Dad, I'm on it. He started applying and all of this. In October, he received a letter that we were so excited about. He received an acceptance letter from the Harrison French and Associates Architectural Agency in Bentonville, Arkansas. And they offered him the job as one of their newest design architects. HFA, as it's called, it's located in Bentonville, Arkansas, and they do all the work for Walmart, you know, nationwide, and do some work for Lowe's, I think, and some other places. And he's on the Walmart team. And I was so excited about that, because when I saw that letter that he had been offered that job and he had accepted, all of a sudden, I started thinking to myself, I had these visions. These visions of him finally moving out of my house. And these visions of him finally being off my payroll, those visions started dancing in my head. And then he looked at me and smiled and he said, Dad, here's the good news. They want me to work from here for the next few months. They're going to send me a computer and get me all set up. They want me to work from here. So I went back to that little calendar that I had in the laundry room, and I just took it down. I said, this is worthless. Well, they finally made the decision. And sometime around the middle of February, they want him to move into an apartment in Bentonville. And so I'm excited again. I can't wait for February to get here in many ways, because now, he's going to move all of his stuff out of that bedroom that he's been using, and I'm going to be able to turn it into my own home office and man cave. At least that's what I want to do. Cindy said we're going to turn it into a bedroom for Annabelle when she comes to spend the weekends with us. But I'm the man of the house. I rule the castle. So we're going to go pick out the paint we think Annabelle's going to like, and The little bed Annabelle's going to like and all that, and we'll do that once he gets all of his stuff out of there. In February, I'm all excited because in February, all of a sudden, the orange juice and the milk in my refrigerator is going to last a lot longer. I'm excited about February because in February, we'll be able to wash our clothes anytime we want to now because our washer and dryer won't be filled with his clothes. I'm excited about February because in February, my DVR won't be filled with all of these recordings of these zombie people. You know, what's that show called? The Living Whoever's or whatever. That's it. You know, I'm excited about that. I'm excited about February because all of a sudden I won't have to clean up three-day-old pizza, you know, that's in his bathroom. I'm excited about February because I won't have to pick up all those vanilla Coke bottles that are all over the place. That stuff tastes nasty. You know, but let me tell you the biggest reason I'm excited about February. I'm excited about February because when February gets here, I'm not going to have to share my Reese's peanut butter cups with anybody. I'll have them all to myself. Yes. Yes, there's a part of me that's excited about February and seeing him get out on his own and off my payroll. But I'm just telling you this. There's the bigger part of me. The bigger part of me hopes that February takes its own dear sweet time in getting here. And you know, there's a part of me that wishes that maybe we could just cancel February altogether. Well, only for a couple of months. Anyway, you folks who are parents, you know what I'm talking about. You know that feeling. There's a part of us that gets excited or was excited when our children grew up and moved out and started to live their lives on their own. There was a part of us that was excited when that happened. But then there was another part of us that felt the heartache of all of that. Having to let them go. And seeing them get out on their own. You know, there are a lot of parents who are going through that right now. Especially if they have seniors in high school. You know, those seniors in high school, some of them are applying to colleges where they want to go. Some of them are thinking about their jobs that they want to take after high school if they're not going to college. There are a lot of parents who are dealing with that excitement and the heartache of, you know, their kids growing up, moving out, and getting on their own. There were a lot of kids who were receiving those letters from those colleges of acceptance, and they're starting to make those applications into other jobs and everything and receiving responses. I love the story about Robert Martin. Robert Martin was the director of admissions for the Mitchell College in New London, Connecticut. He's the director of admissions at the Mitchell College in New London, Connecticut. Last November, he received an application from a young lady. She wanted to go to Milton College. And on the application, there's a question on there that says, do you consider yourself to be a good leader? The question is asked on the college application, do you consider yourself to be a good leader? And she answered no. She said, no, I don't consider myself to be a good leader. And she hoped and she prayed that that wouldn't cost her an admission into the college she wanted to go to. Robert Martin, the director of admissions, sent her a letter 3 weeks ago. And in that letter, it stated that she had been accepted into the freshman class at Mitchell College there in New London, Connecticut. But on her acceptance letter to college, he wrote a personal note on there. In his personal note, he thanked her for her honesty in answering that question, if she considered herself to be a good leader. And he wrote in that note, he said, of all the 700 applicants we had for admission into our college, you were the only one of 700 who stated that you did not consider yourself to be a good leader. The other 699 considered themselves to be great leaders. Then he wrote to her, he said, I'm excited about that because I'm excited to know that next year at least we're going to have one good follower in our freshman class. Jesus Christ had found him a good follower in Philip. Philip had become a follower of Christ. He had listened to what Christ was saying. He was listening to what Christ was preaching and teaching. He was watching all of the things that Christ was doing. And he had come to the belief that Jesus Christ was the Messiah. Jesus was the one sent by God to save God's people. So Philip went to his friend Nathanael. He said, Nathanael, I found him. I found him. I found the one who has been sent by God to save God's people. And Nathanael said, who is he? Who is he? Who is this Messiah, this one sent by God to save God's people? And Philip said, it's Jesus of Nazareth. It's Jesus of Nazareth. And Nathanael offers a strange response. Nathanael said, Jesus of Nazareth? Can anything good come out of Nazareth? It's obvious that Nathanael didn't have a lot of high respect for Nazareth. It's obvious that Nathanael thought Nazareth was some decrepit, sinful place full of bad and evil people. It's obvious that Nathanael thought that, no, the Son of God, the one sent by God to save his people, that one should come from some big, flashy, flamboyant, holy, righteous place, a place like Jerusalem. Now, Jerusalem could produce the person who's going to save God's people, but not Nazareth. There's nothing going on in Nazareth. But you know, Nathanael, he couldn't have been more wrong. He could not have been more wrong in his thoughts about Nazareth. Because the truth of the matter is, there was nothing wrong with Nazareth. I visited Nazareth when I went to the Holy Land and I looked into some of the history there. Back in the days of Jesus, Nazareth was just a small little village full of good, decent, hardworking, faithful people. There was nothing wrong with Nazareth. Oh, sure, it wasn't big and flashy and flamboyant and holy and righteous like Jerusalem. But Nazareth, there was nothing wrong with Nazareth. Nice little town, full of some good people. But could anything good come out of there? You know, when Nathanael raises this question in the Gospel of John, it raises a question for us as a family of faith here at New Life in Little Luling. Can anything good come out of this place? Can anything good come out of this place? I mean, we're not a big, huge crystal cathedral. We don't have 15 ministers on the staff, and our worship service isn't televised around the world every week. We don't have the big chandeliers hanging from the ceiling, and the sermons here aren't published in a manual every month. We don't have tour buses stopping on the street out here for everybody to get out and take pictures. They're not going to put up a big historical marker right outside the front door there that said at one time Reverend Mishy had preached in this location. We're not some rich, huge, big, flamboyant, holy, righteous place. Can anything good come out of here? Can anything good come out of this family of faith? I want you to do something right quick. I promise you this won't hurt. Okay? It won't hurt. All right? I want you to look around you. Go ahead. Look at the people around you. Turn around. Look at the people sitting behind you. You can wave at them if you want to. Be nice and friendly. Yeah, you see everybody. Look at everybody. Look around you. See, that didn't hurt, did it? No, let me ask you this. When you look around, what do you see? Do you see flamboyant, extravagant, holy, righteous, rich people? I don't. I don't see that here. You know what I see? I see a bunch of good, decent, honest, hardworking, God-loving, faithful people. That's what we got here. We're not some big, flashy, flamboyant, holy, righteous cathedral church. Just a group of good, decent, honest, hardworking, God-loving, faithful people. Can anything good come out of this place? I think it does. I think it does. I think it was incredible this summer when we joined together with another church and we had this virtual vacation Bible school. First time we ever tried anything like that. We had to. It was our only choice. Over 100 children were touched by that. And it came from right here. Our little church right here in Luley. I think about Halloween, when kids couldn't go out trick-or-treating like they normally do. So this church brought candy. And I don't think about it because you brought me all those Reese's peanut butter cups. I think about it because that candy was filled up in little bags and people stood out here while kids drove through and at least could experience a little bit of trick-or-treating. And the joy that comes in that. Can anything good come out of this place? I think it does. I think back to how seriously you took the drive, and you do it every year, to provide a Thanksgiving meal to needy families in our community. And I can't even begin to tell you the appreciation that I could feel from those school officials when me and Miss Sue and I, we went over to those schools and delivered those meals. I think about how seriously this church took it to make Christmas a little brighter for kids in Dulac. It was being served by CASA over here. The one thing we learned about our ministry to do like his, next year we need to take batteries. We need to take batteries because there weren't batteries for some of the toys that those kids opened. And they were so thrilled. They were so excited. They couldn't wait to experience the joy of those gifts you furnished. I think about how this is a church. You know, Wayne sits back there and he takes those garbage bags, those plastic bags. I saw people bringing in 3 or 4 bags of them just today. And he knits those things together. And then we collect that food and we send those plastic mats and that food to the homeless in New Orleans. I think about the Bible study that this church participates in, even in a time when we're told we can't do it. We still do it. Our ladies gather on Thursday morning. We have people who gather online through Zoom meetings. All the men gather at El Paso. And we enjoy the food and the fellowship. And they enjoy making fun of the pastor. And that's okay. It's a wonderful time. I think about the love of worship that this place has, and how seriously we take that worship. We love to come here on Sundays. We love to praise God. We love to glorify God. And it doesn't just happen here. Each and every week, it's anywhere from 90 to 120 people. View our worship service on Facebook. That's a lot of people. Because you know most of them are couples, you know? Can anything good come out of this place? We're just a small little church of good, decent, honest, hardworking people who love our faith, who love our church, who love God. We're located right here in this little old town of Luling. Can anything good come out of this place? Folks, good comes out of this place each and every day. It comes out of this place each and every day. And I've been blessed and I've been fortunate to see it happen. And I've only been here 6 months. You know, when Nathaniel said to his friend Philip, when he said, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" What did Philip say to him? He said, "Come and see." He said, "You come and you see what good can come out of Nazareth." That leaves us with a question, friends. A lot of good comes out of this place each and every day. A lot of good. When was the last time you went to someone and you said, "Come and see"? When was the last time you went to someone you knew was hurting and needed the healing and the peace that the church could provide? When was the last time you went to someone like that and said, "Come and see"? Come and see what you can find in my family of faith. When was the last time you went to somebody who you knew wasn't worshiping anywhere, and you knew you could probably really, really benefit from worshiping God? When was the last time you went to them and said, "Come and see"? Come and see what worship is like at my church. Oh, the preaching isn't very good at all, but we got great music. When was the last time you told somebody that? When was the last time you went to somebody who was struggling, maybe even wondering if God cared at all? When was the last time you went to someone like that and said, "Come and see"? Come and see what you can feel and what you can experience. at my church. You know, friends, a lot of folks in the church, especially in the Methodist church, there's a word that scares most of us to death, and that word is evangelism. That word evangelism scares a lot of folks in the Methodist church. And I think it's because we think of evangelism in the wrong way. Evangelism is not knowing all the right words and being able to quote all the scriptures so that you can lead somebody to a profession of faith in Jesus Christ. That's not what evangelism is really about. Evangelism is simply about helping people find their spirit. If not for the first time, maybe find it again. Evangelism is about helping people experience the love and the grace and the acceptance of Christ in their lives. Evangelism is about reaching out to people who are hurting and who are lonely and who are frightened and afraid and helping them find the peace and the assurance that can be found in Almighty God through our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Evangelism isn't something to be afraid of. It's something we do every day here at this church. We do it through all the good. Through all the good that comes out of this little place. So come and see. Come and see. Hopefully that'll become a part of our vocabulary of faith. Would you join with me in a spirit of prayer? Almighty God, we give you thanks for this family of faith. We give you thanks for what this family of faith means to each and every one of us. And we give you thanks for the opportunities that you have afforded us in our lives to be a family of faith, to be your people in this world. Help us, oh God, to not be afraid. To not be afraid of bragging a little bit. Help us to not be afraid to go to others and say to them, come and see. Come and see what my family of faith can do for you in life. We pray this prayer in the name of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our closing hymn today is a wonderful hymn of our faith. I love to tell the story. And as we sing this hymn today, if you're here and you would like to profess your faith in Jesus Christ, become a Christian here today, we want to invite you to come forward as we sing. If you're here today and you'd like to unite with this church by transferring your membership from another congregation, we invite you to come forward as we sing. In whatever way God's Spirit might be leading you to celebrate the good that comes out of this place each and every day and to commit yourself to being one of those persons who goes out into the world and says, come and see. And whatever way God's Spirit might be leading you to respond to that, I want to invite you to do so. As we stand together now and as we join in singing, I love to tell the story.
Jesus, my name is Lord.
A couple of things I'd like to say in these moments. First of all, may God bless our New Orleans Saints this evening. Who dat, huh? Who dat? More important than any of that. Can anything good come out of this place? It does every single day. So let's go from this place and let's say to other folks that are all around us, come and see. Come and see what my church can do for you. And to you, my brothers and my sisters in Christ, go in peace. Sin no more. Love God and serve God's people. Amen.
I love to tell the story.